Hello and welcome to North Texas Teen Book Festival. You are joining us for the Breaking Boundaries panel and we thank you for joining us. I'm Adele Walsh, joining you from Melbourne from the 16 Hour Future. And I'm known in Australia as a YA expert, teen advocate and community outreach coordinator at La Trobe University Library. And I'm also your moderator. In Australia, we begin events with acknowledgement of the lands that can be a little bit tricky in a digital sense, but I would like to take this opportunity to pay my respects to the original storytellers and traditional owners of the lands in which I'm hosting today, the Wurundjeri and Boonwurrung people. I pay my respects to all their elders, past, present, and emerging, and of all the lands that we're working and living on today, and whoever may be joining us watching this panel. I am very happy to be joining Irving, Texas from the other side of the world. But if you want to be part of the conversation, you can do that using the hashtag NTTBF21. So you can watch this panel and maybe hit up more questions of the authors after the fact. So Breaking Boundaries will be featuring four authors who have blurred the lines between genre to capture the imagination of their readers. And I'm absolutely rapt to be joined by JL, author of Wings of Ebony. Yay! Like, I feel like... And Neal Shusterman, author of Game Changer. This is weird. Yes. I'm sure everyone's clapping at home. David Arnold, author of The Electric Kingdom. And Alexandra Bracken, author of Law.
Yay!
Of course, they have written many other stories that you may love, and we'll hear questions from a lot of you about the process and other works in the second part of this panel. But the great thing about having a group of authors together is you can discover new books that you might want to read. And with that in mind, I'm going to ask each of you to give the elevator pitch about what your newest release is about. Like if you're stuck in an elevator for two floors, what would you tell someone? Who's ready first?
Ooh, who wants to go first?
We're waiting for the elevator.
Yes.
I can go first.
Oh, excellent, Alex. Go for it.
Hi, I'm Alex. This is my book, Lore. It's a contemporary fantasy that's set in New York City. And it is about families that are all descended from some of ancient Greece's greatest heroes. And every 7 years for 7 days, they participate in a hunt during which 9 of the Greek gods are cursed to walk the earth as mortal. And if one of these hunters can kill a god, they can take that god's power and immortality. But the big catch is that they themselves will become hunted in 7 years when the hunt begins again. And the main character is, you might have guessed, Lore. And she's left this world behind, wants nothing more to do with it, except, of course, the hunt is not done with her yet. It's back in New York City. And on the very first night, a wounded Athena shows up on her doorstep, seeking her help, but offering Lore the one thing she thought was always impossible, which is vengeance for her murdered family.
Ooh, intriguing. Who would like
murder.
To do that was very well done. It's like you were prepared. And I did not let anyone be prepared for this. I'm sorry. David?
Sure. So my book is The Electric Kingdom. And it's a post-apocalyptic novel set in the woods of New England, roughly 20 years after the end of the world. There are three main characters. There's Nico, who's on the cover with her dog, Harry, who I love dearly. And they have been sent on sort of a vague journey from by Nico's father to find what may or may not be a mythical portal. And then the second character is a 12-year-old aspiring or burgeoning artist named Kit, who's raised in an old abandoned cinema with his mom and his adopted siblings. And then the third character is a character called the Deliverer, who lives on a mountain in a house of electricity. And the Deliverer is omnipotent and omniscient and happens to sort of be in the right places at the right times to kind of interweave all of their stories together. So we'll talk about post-apocalyptic versus apocalyptic and all that later on, but that's the only
and
question.
Then current reality as well. Yes. I can see everyone's faces going, how's that going to work? That's fascinating. It is. Just that's knitting all together. Neal, how about you?
My new book is Game Changer, which just came out a couple of weeks ago. And Game Changer is about a high school football player who tackles so hard that he bounces into alternate dimensions. But each alternate dimension he bounces into, he has to face different social situations. So he gets this crash course in racism, sexism, homophobia, and privilege through these world-bending events that hit him harder than he hits on the field.
Oh, that was well done, Neal. Yeah. I like crash course whilst also getting smashed is fantastic. And Jess, how about you?
Sure. So my book, Wings of Ebony, which came out a month ago, actually, is about Rue, who is a Black teen from an inner city community. When her mother is murdered on her doorstep, her father, that she's never known, she grew up with just her mom, takes her to this veiled island off the coast of Africa that's full of magic wielders. And only she and her father are the only brown-skinned people on the island. So the story is about her exploring her dual identity and understanding sort of what her ancestors see in her and the literal power that's there. And she must embrace those things and fully grasp those things in order to protect her community back home and ultimately solve her mother's murder.
So good. and that was all beautifully done. So hopefully people are already like, I want to get my hands on that book, or you've already read it and feeling very smug about the fact you know what happens. I've got some individual questions for the authors, and then we will get into some shared questions, and then we'll ask some of the student questions. And they were fantastic questions, so thank you for sending them in. My first question is for David. The fly flu is a scary antagonist. One that hits harder in COVID times. So what was the catalyst for this villain, and what rules did you have to consider for a fly flu?
Yeah, it's hard to say, right? Fly flu.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was really interesting. So I mean, I first had the idea for the book back in 2013 when I was taking care of my then 6-month-old son, who is now, he'll be 9 in May, which is bizarre to think about. I had this image of a boarded up farmhouse in the woods and this family who lived in it. And I didn't know who the family was or why they were there or what was going on. And so that was like, this was that book that lived in a file on my computer that through the years I would kind of just dump ideas into as they came. And kind of felt like, I don't think I can really turn to this book yet. I hadn't really found out like what was the big question I was trying to answer, who were my characters and all of that. So really, it was really right around like early 2017 when, it was the heart of Trump's America and wanting to just sort of every morning burn it to the ground and start over and feeling like I was in a place where I was ready to kind of tackle that kind of story. I worked on it for basically 2 straight years. It was a really challenging, very rewarding process. But I will say, you know, as far as, I mean, we had picked February 2021 as the publishing date by, I think, February of 2020, or maybe even January of 2020, or it was well before quarantine started. And right around March of 2020, I called my agent and I was like, I don't know what we should do. I didn't want it to be I wanted to be like not tone deaf and kind of understanding, like, is this the right time for this story? And my publisher and my agent, and we all kind of talked about it. And ultimately where we landed is that this is a book, it's not about the apocalypse. It's not about the end of the world. It's set 20 years after the fact. And it's really sort of forced me to like confront the difference between apocalyptic fiction and post-apocalyptic fiction. So apocalyptic fiction, you have kind of how did the world end and like what happened and how it all went down. And post-apocalyptic fiction is about those people who survived. So it sort of naturally shifts the focus away from what happened onto who did it happen to. And also it sort of naturally makes it a more hopeful place because you already have these characters who have survived the end of the world and are trying to kind of navigate you know, a new world. So I do feel like my hope is that it provides hope, but certainly the timing has been bizarre. There's no getting around it.
And I think that's something people have to realize is a book is in incubation period for a very long time before it comes out. It's not just something that just appears out of nowhere.
Right.
It was also a weird year to have the Stand miniseries come out, let's be honest, as well. As you were talking, it made me think about how much as a teenager I really liked the Kevin Costner movie, The Postman, which is about that hope and reestablishing contact with each other and seeing a future after the worst scenario has happened. So that makes me feel less nerdy about liking that movie.
Yeah, sure. Well, and the book, The Postman, also is really great. I don't know. I think it's a book first. It's a book. It was a book first. Just like
it's not YA though.
No, it's not YA. It's not YA. But it does. I don't know. There is inherent hope in post-apocalyptic fiction. Not all of post-apocalyptic fiction, but the genre in general is saying you've survived the worst. Now what? And exploring that was very rewarding for sure.
And it's a really good metaphor for your teen years too, I guess.
Yes, for sure. Like the stakes are as high as they get, really.
So Alex, Lore presents a world of Greek gods, something many readers are very familiar with from different media types. So what did you have to consider in making it your own perspective of what people can be very familiar with?
Yeah, you know, I grew up with Greek mythology and my mom's side of the family is Greek. And so her way to kind of like start talking to us about that side of our heritage was to give us Dallaire's Book of Greek Myths. So I was introduced to them, like I said, at a really young age, possibly too young considering how like dark and twisted a lot of the stories actually are when it comes down to it. But I was like obsessed with this book and these illustrations and these stories and feeling that sort of like connection to that world, even though it was very, 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 very distant at that point, but it just felt very special to me. And so I'd always wanted to write some story that used Greek mythology, but I wanted to try to kind of challenge myself. So it wasn't necessarily a straightforward retelling, because what I wanted to do was almost more of like a modern myth. I wanted to capture those things that I really loved about the myths, the darkness, the moral ambiguity, these like bigger than life characters, and of course the gods themselves. And I wanted to make it feel a little more modern and relevant to today's readers. And so when I was trying to kind of craft Lore, I knew I wanted to use some sort of like competition framework because of how important competitions were in ancient Greece and how important hunts were in ancient Greek culture. And I knew I had to figure out a way to make the gods feel scary and like they are not completely human, and to make sure, because I think it can go like very not cheesy necessarily, but sometimes when you put a god on a page or put a god on a screen, it can feel a little bit silly. And so I wanted to try to avoid that and make sure that I was able to bring in all of that darkness from the original stories and all of the like, the tension and the big epic stakes that happen in the original stories. But also I wanted to address a lot of the issues that I've always had reading these stories. For example, the amount of sexual violence, the fact that women weren't really allowed to go on these big adventures the way men were, the fact that like women also seemed punished anytime they really expressed any kind of human emotion like rage or ambition or jealousy. And so I just like went to town on it, and I wrote the story that I really wanted to read when I was a kid. And so I hope everybody likes it, my take on a modern myth.
I think it's so important to express like female rage is something we haven't really historically seen in like any kind of medium, and it's always there. It's just a lot more quiet usually until it's not. I think that's always great to explore that.
Yeah, and honestly, I was really brainstorming the book around the rise of the Me Too movement. And so a lot of that filtered into the emotional core of the story. And that's one of the reasons why Medusa becomes such a symbol within the book. So yeah, I really embraced the idea of female rage and just how it's how we're so often taught to suppress that and taught to suppress our ambition. And what happens when there's a girl who's within a very patriarchal society who has that rage and who has that ambition? Like, what does that ultimately look like? So,
yeah. I think it's really interesting that it's part of your cultural, your family culture as well, because I think it's sort of easy to think of ancient, like Greek myths, yeah, as not being part of someone's culture. It's sort of become
I mean, to be fair, yeah, ancient Greek culture is very different from modern Greek culture.
Yes,
but I think she just, that was my mom's, you know, it was something that she really loved as a kid too. So, you know, she also took us to Greek festivals and all of that too. But this was kind of like a very easy way to start talking about that side of the family.
I can remember reading a biblical picture book when I was like younger of all the tales, and that's pretty dark too. So like, it's interesting that that's like, that, like how young you read that is amazing, but I thought it was pretty awesome. Jess, Wings of Ebony is an urban fantasy novel, which a lot of like, it's very hard to sort of explain because urban fantasy can be different depending on what that author's perspective of that would look like. And I'm really like curious about like knitting fantastical realms with everyday life, because sometimes reality feels extraordinary and sometimes extraordinary needs to be realized and grounded to be real. So I'm really curious about like what the approach was in knitting together Houston and is it Gizon?
Yeah.
Yes, excellent. Together to tell Rue's story. So what did you have to consider in that world building?
That's a great question. You know, I wanted to, so I love contemporary books. I love fantasy, obviously, but I love contemporary stories as well because of how incredibly like head on they can be with like topically, you know? So a lot of times I'm drawn to contemporary, be it like a romance or, you know, something like Dear Justice, which is one of my favorite books. And so I found that I wanted to make sure I could really hit the nose with some of the issues that I wanted to explore. But I wanted to give the reader just enough escape. So making it one step removed from reality by adding that veneer of fantasy. I also think there's something to be said. I mean, Wings of Ebony deals with some really gritty, tough, relevant themes. And so I think there's something to be said for taking these situations that can feel, where you can feel so incredibly powerless in real life, and not shying away from talking about them, but in that same vein, giving the character magic as the solution. I think that there's something really beautiful about that contrast there and how that can engage the reader and inspire them to sort of think beyond their immediate circumstances in terms of solutions to things that feel, you know, like huge big world problems that are very real problems. I think there's something really inspiring when you sprinkle magic into their hands, literally and figuratively, to encourage them to sort of digest the story in this sort of limitless power sort of way. I love that the essence of magic and what that did in like Wonder Woman, so nod to Greek mythology. I actually grew up with a lot of Greek mythology too, for just randomly, because it was a big part of my school curriculum at the time. So I'm a huge
fan. I'm so glad you said that, because it was also a really big part of mine. And I feel like everyone I've brought it up with has been like, you learned about Greek mythology in school? Yes.
Oh, I did too in Australia, so it's not weird.
Like, those were the stories that I learned a lot about. And it just, it was so, dark, but it was really fascinating to imagine these stories. And so, you know, I look at like Wonder Woman and like Diana on the first Diana. I actually haven't seen 1984, but the first one I absolutely loved. And I loved Wakanda and Black Panther. I loved Spider-Verse. Like, so I wanted to draw on sort of this feministy, really powerful heroine, but I wanted to like steep it in enough of our real world so that the reader can really sort of immerse themselves completely without me sacrificing a ton of pacing. Like, I wanted to pace it like a page turner. So you pick it up, you can't put it down. It's not a super long book as far as fantasy is considered. And that was an intentional choice because I wanted to engage the reader sort of in the hype, in the passion and the urgency of the plot. And then by the time they realize they're sort of, you know, eyeballs deep into this world and in love with Rue and rooting for her to win, then I sort of round out and sort of make these themes that I put in the book that tie into real world relevance. I make them a little bit more prominent. But by that point, you're like committed. And so you can't go anywhere. And so that was an intentional choice. In terms of the two worlds, I tried to create, I tried to make one a mirror of the other. I think sometimes, you know, discussing sort of the themes in a book, particularly in a contemporary book, if they're particularly heavy or if they're relevant to the things happening in the real world, can be sometimes a challenge. And sometimes I think that readers shy away from having sort of those direct conversations. So what I love is that in the fantasy world, you get to have this sort of nuanced allegorical exploration of these real world issues. And you can sort of take that as far as you're comfortable in your book club groups or whatever. So, I mean, at the core, I wanted it to be this really fantastical, you know, magical adventure with this black heroine at the center of the story, who's full of rage and power and magic. But I wanted to make sure that there was a very clear picture of what she's fighting against, and that was very reminiscent of the real world.
Yeah, I love that point you made about sort of like magic being like a release valve to like sit in some of the stuff that we're dealing with every day. And if I think about a lot of fantasy that I've read, I probably read more about like refugee crises and things like that in fantasy than I have in contemporary settings, and that distance does allow you to sit in it a little bit more without feeling too heavy, so you can think about it a bit more, and that empathy comes to the top. So important. Oh, excellent. And Neal, in Game Changer, Ash suffers. You did such a good job on your explanation of the book. I feel it kind of makes my question null and void. But Ash suffers a concussion that propels him through a range of experiences outside of his own. And I had to ask, why a concussion? But I think your explanation kind of sealed that because it's magnificent. And how do you approach mapping out different versions of realities while considering the emotional growth of that character? That's complicated.
Well, I mean, writing Game Changer was really a challenge for that reason, because, I mean, he's bouncing into different worlds, and it's not so much that he's getting a concussion as his hits are giving the world a concussion. So in each world, he has to face an entirely new reality, and he's the only one who remembers how it was. And it's not sort of in an episodic way. The worlds layer on top of one another and build on one another. So sort of trying to see, okay, now I've created this world, and then the next one, I have to add all of this on top of it. And eventually it just starts to, it's not like building one world, you're building multiple worlds, and it becomes very unwieldy. And so it was quite a challenge to bring all those worlds together and make them work. I mean, like in the first world he bounces into, just a little bit, tiny things are different. You know, the stop signs are blue instead of red. But all the ramifications of that, you know, have there been more accidents because of that, or different people alive because they didn't see the stop sign? And then in the next one, he's rich, but stop signs are still blue. And then the next one, stop signs are blue, he's rich, and the United States is still segregated. And he has to deal with the horror of that, and the realization that our world as it is now isn't all that different, that we have not come as far as we'd like to believe we've come. And so in the course of the story, he's learning all of these lessons about our world by seeing all these different worlds and by seeing who he is in all these different worlds, because he has memories, not just of who he was, but who he is in this world. The way I tried to describe that was, you know that box of junk that you have in the closet or in the garage? You have no idea what's in it.
A whole room.
Yes.
A whole room of junk.
But you have no idea what's in it until you open it. And then when you open it, you know every single item. You have a memory of every single thing in there. But until you've opened, you couldn't have. Each of the worlds he bounces into, that's what it's like for him. Only when he sees it, only when he's experienced it, does he remember the memory of how it connects to this new world and who he is in the world. And so he's not just growing, but he's learning about himself and who he became in these different worlds. So it's really about empathy and about seeing the world from all of these different perspectives and trying to take that, you know, the conceit of the story of the world bouncing and really focus it in on the character and the things that the character is learning and how the character is learning social responsibility and to accept accountability for the mistakes that he's made and for the things that he hasn't seen and hasn't addressed in his life and in his world.
That's, yeah, the planning that would be a nightmare. It also made me think of the DC TV shows on CW, and they had an infinite crisis. And so all the heroes remember the two realities, but their new reality has completely shifted from where they were. And so they've had to live with that. And also I think about like what WandaVision's been doing at the moment of different realities building upon one another to sort of have an emotional truth is like, it's really sophisticated. So thank you for explaining that in a way that my brain could work around.
Yeah, no, that
speaking
was
of multiverses, I saw an article today that said scientists have proven that multiverses exist.
Is that what deja vu is?
Yeah, I have no idea. Could
Neal,
be.
That was such a beautiful explanation of the box. It was like it immediately captured the emotion of that. That was such an amazing explanation for it.
Oh, thanks. You know, so many times trying to explain things that are hard to explain or easier when you can figure out what the real world parallel is. And so that's, but it's always hard trying to find that real world parallel when you're dealing with something that is fantastical.
Yeah, most definitely. So I've got a few questions for all of you now, and I'll say your name so we don't get vocal crossover. So anything is possible in genre, and I really like that genre isn't becoming this hard and fast thing. There's lots of like gray areas and like, or like it's collision of all of it. What is your most favorite rule that you've created in your world? Because anything is possible, but there does have to be rules sometimes, or maybe not.
So I'll just jump in here. Okay, cool. So the main characters in the Electric Kingdom are mostly teens or younger, and the apocalypse had happened roughly 20 years prior. So the main characters have grown up in this world, knowing nothing that came before it. So one rule that I had that was kind of challenging going through was basically everything had to be filtered through the lens of what their parents had told them or what they'd read in books, because there was no internet, there's no, there's no technology, there was no other. So I'd write whole chapters that my editor would be like, they wouldn't, and I can't think of a specific example, but I had to filter a lot of things through books and through things that their parents had told them. Which was certainly challenging, but I love books though that, you know, going into this, it is, you know, it's post-apocalyptic, so it's got the rules of reality. It's not a fantasy novel necessarily, but some of my favorite authors, Ted Chiang right now, is just, I can't get enough of his work. And I walked into a movie in 2015 thinking it was an alien movie, and I left like a completely changed person. And that movie was Arrival, which led me to Ted Chiang's work. And the idea that you can incorporate just elements of sci-fi into a reality, and the windows that opens in terms of character development. And it's just, anyway, I'm rambling now, but that was a really fun realization and something that I really wanted to explore a lot in this book.
The Arrival is such a beautiful alien story. Like, it's usually so violent what we see, and I think there was just such beauty and peace to a lot of the Arrival. It's just stunning. I will always remember Nico being shocked that some of the others hadn't read Harry Potter, and that sort of plays into your role. Like, they might not have wanted to, but they might not have heard about it either.
Right. And so, and then presenting the, you know, and actually my love of Ted Chiang, I wrote into the book because one of the other characters, Lennon, is like, I don't have time for Harry Potter. I'm too busy reading Ted Chiang. And so there is that sort of like, I do love kind of putting my own sort of favorites into the world. So,
Alex, did you have a rule?
Yes. So one of the most important rules in the book, just coming from me as an author rather than the rules of the hunt themselves, was I had to limit the power that the original gods had. They no longer have like complete access to their own abilities, but they do have some power when they are in their mortal forms. And so it gave me a way to explore, you know, their more central identities. Like, who are they without this power? Like, who are they if they are not actually controlling the humans and the mortals around them? Same thing, human and mortal. But it was, yeah, it was just like, I knew they would never, no mortal would ever be able to essentially kill them if they had this limitless power at their disposal. And it, I think too, sometimes we want to give our characters like all of the really cool, amazing abilities because it's fun to write, but then it sort of ends up deflating the stakes a little bit because there's no real sense that something terrible could happen to them. And so I wanted the readers to have the sense that the gods really could die, like their powers could fail them, what powers they have left could fail them right when they needed them most. But also, yeah, where was I gonna go with this? Yeah, I think that's what I would say about it. I really had a lot of fun exploring. I remember what I was gonna say, completely lost my train of thought there. But one of the things I love about Greek mythology is that a lot of the punishments, while they were like always very harsh, there was always a little bit of irony to them. And so my feeling was if these gods are being essentially punished for betraying Zeus and they have in the process killed a lot of mortals, and we'll leave it at that, so it's a little spoiler free, but I wanted them to feel that powerlessness and to feel at the mercy of other beings too. So that ended up being, I think, the most important rule on my end as a writer, that the gods had to be somewhat limited in their power, so there would be real stakes.
Well, you can't have Superman without kryptonite and lead, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Lead impairs his abilities and kryptonite can kill him. So otherwise he would be super boring.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
it's interesting too, because I remember like one of my favorite writing tips was that sometimes, you know, we want to make the conflict as huge as possible, like it's not going to destroy a city, it's going to destroy the world, but the reader knows that the world is not going to be destroyed by the end of the book in theory. So it actually, to make the conflict smaller actually makes it feel like it could happen, and it adds more tension to the story too. So.
And Jess, did you introduce a rule for yourself, for your characters, that you really had to consider?
Yeah. So one of the rules to the magic, or the way the magic works in Kazan, is that they're sort of related. So the first rule is that this magical island is secret. It's not like the people in Chicago and DC and LA know, oh, there's this magical island off the coast of Africa. So working with the idea that it's a secret, one of the ways that magic can work is that if a person from Kazan touches a person who is not from Kazan, so like a non-magic, they can transfer their memories. And the memories, the emotion from the memories is not transferred. It's just sort of, think of like a Rolodex of images just in your head. It plays a really interesting part of the plot and a plot twist. So I love that magic and sort of the way it sort of creeps, its importance creeps up on the reader. But then it also is a nod to sort of like how powerful the things you know are. And sort of this idea, you know, my teacher hat constantly slips on. I used to be an educator. And so I think about sort of the way that we, like when you learn something or you know something, or you're, you know, researching something about the world or government or the way it works, or you're whatever it is, there's so much power in just the knowing, and you can do things with that knowledge. And so it was sort of inspired by that idea, though it doesn't manifest that way in the story at all, but it was sort of a nod to that. And it plays a very cool role, I think, in the story, and in a particular plot twist. So
I like the idea of a muggle download.
Yeah.
But I would like to do that to myself because I forget a lot of stuff I know. Like it's just there somewhere. Yeah.
It only happens the first time you make contact. So, you know, in the first chapter.
I couldn't really, I'm not magical.
The first time you make contact, it happens, and it's sort of everything sort of in the past that that has happened. And it presents some interesting dilemmas because, again, there's no emotion or sound attached to these things. It's just sort of fractured images.
Excellent. And Neil?
I would say that my favorite rule in Game Changer has to do with how the multiverse works. And basically, Ash, when he bounces out of this world and into another one, there is this place that I call the Elsewhere, which is kind of in between. And each time he goes in there, he sort of has a different, a little bit of a larger view of what's going on in there. And he senses all of these different universes, all of these different realities wanting to exist. There's, in a sense, they're alive and craving existence. And so they're all grabbing for him and they're all trying to become the world that he falls into. And so that whole idea of the multiverse being alive, I thought was a really fun idea. And also the idea that the universe, that there's always somebody in the universe who's doing this. I called it the subjective locus, the person who is changing reality through some event. And there's always somebody, not always here on Earth, because the universe is huge. And so it could be someone, you know, so far away that it doesn't even affect us, but only 20 times, only 40 times in the past has it been on Earth, but half those times it was a dolphin. And of the ones who survived, the humans who in the past have survived through this, all of them, there's only 9 of them who have survived. And they have gone on to lead world-changing lives. And a question that I always get asked when I mention that in the story, people are always asking me, who were the 9? Who were the 9 in history? And I sort of give my sinister little chuckle to that, because it's up to you to decide who they were.
Yeah, but of course, dolphins, of course. Right? You just have to nod at that. It's like, hang on. We have about time to probably answer a few of the student questions. So we'll get cracking. We've got quite a few, but we'll see how many we can get through. There is a question from Audrey at Jasper High School who asks, Neal, are your series meant as a cautionary tale of the world's future?
Neal? A lot of my stories are cautionary tales. They're explorations of all the things that can go right and all the things that can go wrong. I try to see my stories as ways of giving perspective on a problem in the world and trying to look at it from as many different points of view as possible. Because, I mean, the way I see it, the only way we're really going to solve the problems is if we broaden our perspective as wide as possible. And so I'm always trying to broaden the perspective of my characters and the readers. So, yes, they're cautionary tales, but they're also stories that are meant to give you that new view that you hadn't seen before, or pose a question that you hadn't even thought of asking.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Got another big question for everybody from Tarun or Taryn. I don't know if my accent is making me interpret that the wrong way. Jasper High School, Taryn, have there been any times when you want to express your feelings about something in writing and you decided to censor yourself because you feared public outcry? They're hitting you with the hard ones. Anyone?
Yes. But wait, I'm supposed to be keeping it a secret, so I can't say. So a big part of my main character's relationship is with her father. And just to put it succinctly, I did not grow up with my dad very present. So a lot of her rage was me processing my own.
Yeah, I think I end up processing a lot on the page too. With Lore, I was really thinking about all the times I had kind of suppressed my own ambition, because that was considered like an unflattering trait for a woman to have, to seem too ambitious or too climbing, and how I've really held myself back over the years. So I don't, usually I'm working something out on the page and I don't hold back.
I
sometimes I think that, that
Go now.
Sometimes it's as if, you know, you're working through something, and many times you don't even realize that you are.
Yeah.
That there's all of the subconscious stuff going on. I mean, when I was working on Scythe, I didn't realize until after I finished it, when somebody asked me what was going on in my life when I came up with the idea, that I realized that I was actually really working through the death of my mom through what was happening in Scythe. And that revelation, I went back and read parts of Scythe again and realized it's obvious. It was obvious that I was doing that, but it wasn't obvious to me at the time.
Yeah, that same thing happened with my first novel, Mosquito Land. The half the book is told in letters that the main character is writing to someone named Isabel. And I wrote it as I was taking care of my son, newborn baby, and realized long after the fact that those are just me writing letters to my kid. Mm-hmm. But like, you know, as I'm doing it, I would have sworn, no, this is fiction. This is, you know, and of course the things that are happening are fictional, but man, I read some of those letters and I'm like, this is me writing a letter to my kid. Yeah.
I think our feelings are always there. They might not be coming through the way that we want them to, but I think there's a very thin veneer between intention and perception of what you're like. Yeah, like if you see a girl crying, it's not usually because they're sad. It's usually because they're angry. Sorry.
Yeah.
And they're getting angry at themselves for being angry. this is a good one from Kevin from Jasper High School. Do you hide any secrets in your books that only a few people will find? Huh. And are you allowed to tell anyone, I guess, is the question.
I borrow my friends' funny lines sometimes when they make like a joke or...
Oh, Alex, you've gone muted.
There we go. Can you hear me okay?
Now we can, yeah.
Okay, my AirPods just died. Very helpfully just died.
And you dealt with that so gracefully.
I was saying that I borrow my friends like funny and witty lines, and I like to borrow some of their quirks and their hobbies, and usually only they will get it. And they appreciate that the character is not completely based on them, but they can kind of get that little inside joke. Sometimes I have like a little authorly inside joke that nobody else gets, but it makes me laugh too, so. Do you guys do that too, or are you
all the time? All the time, and sometimes I get to do commentaries on the books. You know, like for some special editions, I could do a chapter by chapter commentary. So in those, I'll point out the little like Easter eggs that are in there. I used to have this Easter egg character, Ralphie Sherman, who was in every single book, just in one way or another, just for fun. And so readers are always looking. Says where did I insert Ralphie Sherman secretly? And then I got tired and then I stopped doing it. But now I still have readers who are saying, where's Ralphie Sherman in that book? So now I have to start putting him back in.
Yeah, how dare you now?
You should write that book, Where's Ralphie Sherman?
Yeah. And they try to knit it all together. That'd be amazing.
I did something where I tried and I succeeded for the first three. So I found at the end of Mosquito Land, I wrote something about being a kid of appetite. And so then that was the title of book two. And then late in the edits of book two, I landed on a title for book three. And so I incorporated that title. So I have like Easter eggs with my titles. Very Taylor
Swift. Yeah.
Yeah. But so it kind of fell apart with this book, but I do have mention in my third book, I do have mention of Nico, and that's the main character in this book. So there is like a thread there.
Also, as soon as I saw I Am the Messenger being mentioned, I knew what was going on.
Monty Python.
There is always at least one or two Monty Python or Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy references in the book somewhere.
Nice. Oh, you're all like Taylor Swift's, very meta.
Yeah.
Or maybe someone else that's not Taylor Swift, but Taylor Swift's making some bank right now, so good for her, I guess. I've got time for maybe two more questions. One for Alex. When did you first realize you wanted to be an author? I guess everyone can answer this one as well.
Yeah, I would love. Can you guys hear me still?
Oh, sorry. It's from Hope from Bowie Middle School. When did you first realize? Sorry.
My computer just was like, we're switching back to the AirPods like microphone. I was like, no.
Yeah, so Hope from Bowie Middle School, when did you first realize you wanted to be an author?
Hope, that is a great question. I definitely want to hear everybody else's answers. I was one of those like very intense children where I like knew in third grade that I wanted to be an author, and specifically that I wanted to write books for kids, because I was such a big reader at that age. And I was like, if it's this much fun to read, it's going to be this much fun to actually write books. And that was also probably not a coincidence the year that my we started doing like creative writing units. Like we would write these little picture books that they would bind with like cardboard and contact paper, and we could like write and illustrate our own little stories. I still have mine about the origins of the asteroid belt in the universe. Like it was really fun. And I just like knew, I knew from a really young age, and I always wrote after that. I wrote a lot of fan fiction all through middle school and high school and even into college, but college was really the first time I tried to write my own original stories and original novel.
Jess, how about you? When did you know?
You know, it's interesting. When I was little, I wanted to be a different thing, sort of like every new grade, usually inspired by a movie I saw. Like I wanted to be a sharpshooter for the CIA, and then I wanted to be a feminist, and then I wanted to be an actress for a while. At one point I wanted to be a full-on unicorn. So I realized as I was older that what I really wanted to do was tell stories from all of these different perspectives and be all of these things through literature. I love to write, I always loved to write, but I actually, just with my upbringing and sort of where I came from, and sort of, I'm the first person in my family to go to college, and then I went on to grad school. I didn't feel like I had the freedom to pursue something that I wanted to. I felt like I needed to pursue something that felt more practical. So I was pursuing pre-med and then law for a while. And eventually when I decided organic chemistry was gonna flunk me out of college, I was like, I'm going to pick something I like. And that's when I settled on journalism. And journalism is storytelling sort of in its own way. And it wasn't until I started to see more of myself in books on shelves, like in 2017 with The Hate U Give and Dear Martin and several other books, that I began to say, okay, maybe I can do this. But it wasn't until 2018 that I had the courage to sit down and actually try.
Less people who actually like organic chemistry, because that, you know, just go forth. what about you, David? How did you know? Or did you always know?
No, I definitely didn't always know. I've always been a big reader, and I did have, like, there was a moment in seventh grade when I discovered Jurassic Park by Michael Crichton, and I read it literally over and over again, till the point where the cover, it was a paperback, but still, the cover fell off the book, and I just kept reading it. Then I thought, well, maybe I'll be an author, which to my seventh grade mind meant I just need to sit down and literally type out Jurassic Park word for word. So like I got probably 300 or 400 pages. That's what I remember. I'm sure it wasn't that much.
Whoa.
Into it. But I was on my dad's like old boxy, you know, beige computer. And I came back to work one day of typing out the manuscript for Jurassic Park when my brother deleted it all. My little brother had deleted it all and like typed in, you do realize you're just copying word for word Jurassic Park. And I was like, no.
That's so brutal.
yeah. I've never forgiven him for that. But, no, I read out of college. I mean, I was in music for 10 years in Nashville. Like music was going to be my thing, and it was for a long time. And then my wife and I found out that we were going to have a baby, and I had a home studio. So I did a lot of recording at the house, which you can't do with a baby. And I was a freelance musician. And so, and she had this great job with benefits and, you know, the things you need, especially when you're having a kid. And so like pretty much overnight, it was decided that I was going to be a stay-at-home dad of our newborn, you know, baby son. And I had no idea what I was doing, but that was really when it would have been 2011 or 2012 was when I decided to get really serious about writing, because I knew that music wasn't going to be something I could do for a while. So, but it's worked out. I mean, this was a career that I didn't know you could really even have, even though I was a reader for so long. I just kind of assumed that who could actually do that like for a living. And now that I found it, it's like, it's more fulfilling than music ever was.
Great. And Neil, how about you?
Organic chemistry. I was a bio sci major when I was in college. Yes. But my heart wasn't in it. I mean, I knew by that point that I wanted to be a writer, but O-Chem just made me realize, no, this is not for me. And I changed my major to psychology and theater, you know, the science of mind and behavior and the art of mind and behavior. And I knew that I wanted to be a writer, but everybody I knew who wanted to be a writer was an English major. And I figured I'd approach it from a different perspective. And also I didn't like writing analytical essays. So I figured I could just take the creative writing courses. So I took every single creative writing class that the university offered, and then actually got to do independent study with the head of the writing program there when they ran out of creative writing classes. But you know, it was really in high school that I had a great ninth grade English teacher who really encouraged me to write. And then during the summers when I was in college, I worked as a counselor at a summer camp and got to be known as the storyteller. And so as the storyteller, I constantly had to come up with stories to tell. And, you know, there's kind of a power to being a storyteller. I mean, I could walk into, once I got, you know, this reputation, I could walk into any cabin in the entire camp and the kids would fall silent before me because they knew that they were going to get a story. And if they weren't quiet, I'd walk away and tell it to a different cabin. So so it was kind of fun. But then the kids would always say, why don't you write those stories into books? And so during the school year, I would take one of the stories, one of their favorite stories, write it into an entire book, make copies of it. And the next summer I would come back and I would give them the actual book. I even drew my own covers. And then I tried to get those books published. And of course they didn't get published because they were terrible, but you know, each one got a little bit better. And the third one was the one that was published. And so that's what got me started, you know, being a storyteller at camp.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for sharing your origin stories. Like a lot of hard work. Spelling and grammar, not necessarily the thing you have to focus on, rather than understanding people and being a good storyteller and finding out what works for an audience. We have sadly run out of time, but time flies when you are having fun. So I would like to give a very big thank you to our panelists, Jess, David, Alex, and Neil. A big thank you to all the viewers out there, and a big yay to the NTTBF organizers. Thank you for creating a space for book lovers to share ideas and find new books that you just have to read. You can check out more of the panels from this festival on the NTTBF YouTube. And if you'd like some books or swag, you can head to the website, website.bookshop.org/shop/NTTBF. And on that note, I'd like to say farewell from the future.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.